Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman speaking. Let's listen in.
Which is a result of a lot of consultation. I know many members in the opposition have said, have you had any consultation at all? I'd like to draw their attention to say that in the manifesto of the BJP, where the consultations did happen, not just this time, it has been one of the commitments of the party since the time of Jan Sangh. And periodically, if we take the name of Professor and also the youngest Vice Chancellor who was part of the ministry, which was of the, it was a united kind of a ministry which Jawaharlal Nehru ran the first cabinet, in which Syama Prasad Mookerjee was a minister. He was taken up to this cause, and we all know that he lost his life in very, very suspect circumstances, all in the name of wanting to keep one constitution, one samvidhan, that is one pradhan and one constitution. So if that is the kind of core belief that this party, Jan Sangh, and also BJP subsequently have had, it is only as a result of constant consultation, discussion with people concerned, and even as latest as 2019, our manifesto during the Lok Sabha election was elaborately mentioning the need for the abrogation of Article 370. All this is not without consultation. And therefore, to think that we've just popped it out of somewhere, you know, suddenly from the hat like a magic rabbit, not at all. This has been on for a very long time. All of us have been talking about it. So that is one thing. And second, haven't we seen over the years very progressive legislation, some of which happened even during Congress's time, like the Panchayati Raj Act, 73rd and 74th Amendment to the Constitution, did they get effectively implemented from the same time as was the rest of the country? No. There had to be a lot of persuasion, in spite of the merit of the issue, persuasion to make sure that such progressive kanun, such progressive legislations which are happening in the entire country, for it to be implemented in Jammu and Kashmir. The latest being, and the one which all of us have been talking about for several years, is the equal right for women, which is not even today implemented in Jammu and Kashmir. Girls who are born, ladies who are born in Jammu and Kashmir are denied their property rights, even as they get married to people who are settled outside of Jammu and Kashmir, which is a gross injustice. And that gross injustice has never been addressed with sincerity. If only that kind of an injustice can be addressed, even before we took it up today, today the House didn't have to see the scenes that it saw. And I can tell you, even with many of us traveling into Jammu and Kashmir, we've seen how scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, the Bakarwals about whom all of us speak, never had rights which were given to the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes in the rest of the country. Why should the special status of Jammu and Kashmir start and end with discrimination against women, discrimination against SC, discrimination against ST? If that is the special status, I don't think any one of us in this house can be proud of Jammu and Kashmir with a difference, with inequality so profoundly written on its face. At least because of that, I would have thought members will forget the differences that they had otherwise ideologically and come together today to say, we couldn't do it, but we are happy that you're doing it. We are with you while you're doing it. To give a message to the entire country that 1994, that resolution which was passed in Lok Sabha here about Jammu and Kashmir being an integral part of India, and not just the Jammu and Kashmir which is with India now, but also that Jammu and Kashmir which is under the occupation, illegal occupation of Pakistan. It was a resolution passed in Parliament here. And if that is truly a resolution which was unanimously passed, shouldn't we be keeping up to the letter and spirit of that passing of that resolution? So neither from the point of human rights, nor from the point of view of equal rights for women, nor the point of view of positive affirmative affirmative action for SCs and STs, do we want to talk about Jammu and Kashmir. But we want to talk about it because we've created this whole hype that, oh, the special status is so sacrosanct that even if it denies human rights, we'll be with it. I'm sorry, sir, we've heard several times people in Ladakh who live in a very large area where the population is so sparse, having been demanded that we want a unit territory status because it's too difficult to be administered. We've heard it over and over again, but we have not taken any step. Today, I'm glad after what is happening in this house and later with Lok Sabha, we will be able to meet that aspiration of every Ladakhi for a separate union territory for them. And lastly, sir, I'm glad to say the union territory with the legislature, elected legislature for the Jammu and Kashmir, inclusive of Jammu and Kashmir, which is occupied, parts of Kashmir which are occupied by Pakistan, and the union territory to take care of the needs of Ladakh. From the point of view of aspirations of the people, from the point of view of development, today we call Kashmir paradise. We all want it to be maintained with its pristine beauty. Not one person is willing to go and invest money, even to build a hotel there, to receive the tourists. No investments are happening in Jammu and Kashmir.
Please.
Unless we take this step, which I'm very grateful that the Prime Minister has guided us, and the Home Minister has brought up this amendments, with this development, I am sure the true development and integration of Jammu and Kashmir will happen now onwards.
Good, Mr.
Thank you.